Interpretation and analysis of acid-base disorder. As you all know, acid-base disorders are one of the most important problems which are encountered by physicians who are working in the critical care unit. It is one of the most important investigation in the evaluation of a critically ill patient. In an ABG, you have three components: oxygenation, ventilation and acid-base disorder. As far as the oxygenation is concerned, it gives you a deeper picture of oxygenation, that is oxygen uptake, oxygen transport and utilization of oxygen at the tissue level. It also helps you in assessing the acid-base status. Now, these disorders in many of these patients can become so severe that they can become life threatening. So it is mandatory for the critical care physicians to be well versed with the interpretation of acid-base disorders. How does arterial blood gases as an investigation helps a critical care physician? It not only helps him in making a diagnosis, but also in assessing the severity of illness. Like if you have a case of ARDS, then by through blood gases, through PaO2 and FiO2 ratio, you can quantitate the severity of ARDS. Or from a patient who comes to you with acute exacerbation of COPD, from the degree of acidemia this patient has got, you can assess the severity of acute exacerbation of COPD. By knowing this, it guides the physician to plan and help the initial treatment and then subsequent follow-up of the patient, subsequent modification in the ventilator management. Acid-base disorders are also associated with significant electrolyte abnormalities. A severe degree of hypokalemia may be associated with hypokalemia. On the other hand, a severe degree of acidemia may be associated with hyperkalemia. Improvement in the acid-base status is one of the important goals in the management of a critically ill patient. If a patient is grossly acidemic, he may become grossly hypotensive. His hypotension may become refractory and may not be responsive to vasopressor. So any patient who has a refractory shock and is not responding to vasopressor, and if he has a gross acidemia or alkalemia, the correction of this status will result in the improvement in the hemodynamic status of this patient. So before we go into the exact interpretation of an acid-base disorder, it is very important to understand basic acid-base physiology. You know that acidity of body fluid is expressed normally by pH. Although the acidity of the body fluid is determined by hydrogen ion concentration, but normally the concentration of the hydrogen ion is so small that it is very difficult to express them as nano equivalents per liter. So to express it more easily and easily understandable terms, we express acidity of body fluid by pH, which is the negative logarithm of hydrogen ion concentration. The normal range of pH is between 7.36 and 7.44. A normal pH of 7.4 corresponds to a normal hydrogen ion concentration of 40 nanoequivalent. You know that pH and hydrogen ion are inversely related. That means as the pH rises, the hydrogen ion concentration falls, and as the pH falls, the hydrogen ion concentration increases. It is very important to calculate the hydrogen ion concentration from pH. Normally, the acid-base status is given by the ABG machines as pH, but when we want to test the internal validity of an ABG, it is important to calculate hydrogen ion concentration from pH. Now, this can be done by exploiting this pH and hydrogen ion concentration curve, and you can see that it is actually a curvilinear curve, but in the range of pH of 7.1 to 7.5, this relationship is almost linear. So, from this relationship, we can say that for every change in 0.01 pH unit from 7.4, will change the hydrogen ion concentration by 1 nano equivalent. In other terms, if the pH is 7.39, the hydrogen ion concentration will be 41, and if the pH is 7.41, the hydrogen ion concentration will be 39. The another way you can see is that if there is a change of pH of 0.1, that means from 7.4 to say 7.3, then you can calculate the hydrogen ion concentration by multiplying 40 nano equivalent, which is the hydrogen ion concentration at a pH of 7.4, by 1.25. That means at pH of 7.3, the hydrogen ion concentration will be 40 into 1.25, and that would become 50 nano equivalent per unit. On the other hand, if the pH falls, pH increases by 0.1, that means if it increases from 7.4 to 7.5, the hydrogen ion concentration will fall from 40, and you multiply it by 0.8, and this becomes 32 nano equivalents per liter. In general, it is viewed that if the pH changes by 7.3 units upwards or downwards, the hydrogen concentration will either become half or doubled respectively. In other words, if somebody's pH changes from 7.4 to 7.1, the hydrogen ion concentration will increase from 40 to 80 nano equivalents. So, this is the way you can calculate hydrogen ion concentration from the pH. There are certain important terminologies which you should be aware of, because most of the time it is observed clinically that many people use acidemia and acidosis as interchangeable term. Acidemia is absolute increase in the hydrogen ion concentration or decrease in the pH, whereas alkalemia is the decrease in the hydrogen ion concentration or increase in the pH. So, any pH going above 7.44 will be alkalemia, and any pH which is going below 7.36 will be acidemia. Acidosis is a process, it is a pathophysiological process which tends to acidify body fluids if it is unopposed, and this is determined by two parameters, that is bicarbonate or carbon dioxide. So, if the bicarbonate falls, then this will be metabolic acidosis, or if the PCO2 increases, it will be respiratory acidosis, and if it is not unopposed, then it will lead to acidemia. On the other hand, alkalosis is a process which tend to alkalinize the body fluids. That means it will result either due to increase in the bicarbonate or decrease in the PCO2. So, if unopposed, it will also lead to alkalemia. So, acidemia, alkalemia is associated with change in hydrogen concentration and pH, and acidosis and alkalosis are determined by PCO2 levels and bicarbonate levels. Now, how much acid is produced physiologically in the body per day? It has been observed that about 16,000 milliequivalents of carbon dioxide is produced by metabolism of carbohydrates and fats. This is called the volatile acid. And on the other hand, non-volatile acids in the form of sulfuric acid is produced by metabolism of proteins, and phosphoric acid is produced by metabolism of phospholipids. How are these acids normally removed from the body under physiological condition? The volatile acid in the form of carbon dioxide is excreted through the lungs by increasing the minute ventilation. On the other hand, the acids in the form of phosphoric acid and sulfuric acid, which goes as phosphates and sulfates, are ultimately excreted through the kidney, and there is a regeneration of bicarbonate molecules in the kidney, and the hydrogen ion which is produced joins with these phosphates and sulfates, and there is also in the kidney tubules the formation of ammonium, and which then forms salts with these sulfates and phosphates, and ultimately lead to excretion of these salts. So how is normally the acid base balance of the body fluid is maintained? The pH of the body fluid is determined by the amount of acid produced, both volatile and non-volatile, the buffering capacity of the body, and ability of the lungs and the kidney to excrete this acid load. The body maintains arterial pH within a narrow range of 7.35 and 7.45 despite the onslaught of daily acid production. Physiological pH is necessary to prevent enzyme inactivation and denaturing. So if the pH is not maintained within this narrow physiological limits, then a person is vulnerable to develop lot of pathophysiological changes, hemodynamic changes, and it also will be associated with impairment of various body functions, and they are in the form of poor vascular tone. So if a person has, say, gross acidemia, he may develop refractory hypotension, which may not be responsive to vasopressors. He may develop poor muscular pump and develop congestive heart failure. Electrolyte abnormalities are commonly seen, as you see hypokalemia in patient with alkalemia and hyperkalemia in patient with acidemia. Myocardial irritability resulting into development of various arrhythmias, delirium and altered unconsciousness, muscle weakness, and impaired tissue respiration. So these are very important issues in patients who are critically ill, and if there is a gross derangement of acid base status, it may be very difficult to treat this patient. How does the body respond to an acid load? Now, whenever an acid is added to the body from the body tissues or from outside or from abnormal metabolic states like diabetic ketoacidosis or uremia, there are two to three defense mechanism. When the hydrogen, large amount of hydrogen and concentration are added, there is an immediate response which tends to mitigate this change in the pH, and this happens within seconds to minutes, and this is done by buffers. Now, the buffers are substances which take the ions or release an ion as per the requirement. The second system is the respiratory system, and this becomes particularly active if there is a state of excess carbon dioxide production and by increasing minute ventilation, and this may happen within minutes. And the third is the kidney, which is the main organ and the most important organ involved in the regeneration of bicarbonate and excretion of non-volatile acids. So it takes hours to several days for complete response of the kidney to occur. So that is why if somebody has a respiratory disorder, then the body responds. If there is a change in PCO2, the body has to respond by changing the bicarbonate. It may take few days to occur, and that's why we have immediate changes and delayed changes. So kidney is the most powerful organ for the maintenance of acid base status. So buffer, as we mentioned, is a substance that can either absorb or donate protons to a solution. As you can see, buffer plus hydrogen ion into hydrogen buffer, and this is a reversible reactions. Buffers are very important in mitigating sudden change in the pH, and the most important buffers which we have are bicarbonates, plasma proteins, hemoglobin, and phosphates. Amongst these, if you see that whenever there is a change in the hydrogen ion concentration in a solution, all the buffers will act simultaneously and equally, depending upon their concentration in the body fluids. So this is what we call as isohydric principle. That means if you add a load of hydrogen ion concentration, it will be picked up by bicarbonate, phosphates and hemoglobin buffers. So if you really want to assess the acid-base status of a patient, then it is not necessary to see the changes in all these buffers. In fact, you can choose one of the buffer and from that you can actually calculate the change in the acid-base status. So we most of the time use bicarbonate buffer most commonly because this is the most common buffer. It is present in large amount in the body and so it is easily measurable in the laboratory. So this buffer equation you are all aware of, that with carbon dioxide combines with water, with the help of carbonic anhydrase it forms carbonic acid, which is a very very unstable acid, and that dissociates into hydrogen ion and bicarbonate. And this reaction, as you can see, is a both way reaction. So depending upon the substrate, if the substrates increase on the right side, the reaction will move to the left, and if the substrates are increased on the left side, the reaction moves to the right. Now this equation can be rewritten as pH is equal to pKa, which is a constant log of bicarbonate and carbonic acid. So we can easily measure bicarbonate, but we cannot measure carbonic acid very easily because it is a very very unstable acid and it is in the small quantity. We also know that carbonic acid here is in equilibrium with the dissolved carbon dioxide. So we can actually replace this carbonic acid with carbon dioxide multiplied by 0.03, which is the solubility coefficient. So you can see here that we can rewrite this equation. pH is equal to pKa plus log into 0. Instead of carbonic acid, you can write 0.03 into PaCO2. So this equation, if you put the normal values, so if you put the normal values for carbon bicarbonate and carbon dioxide, as you can see here, the normal value of 24 and 40 milliequivalent, and you solve this equation, then it comes to 20, and log of 120 is 1.3, and here you can see that the normal pH is 7.4. So this is how it is derived, and this is what we call as a Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, where the pH is determined by the concentration of bicarbonate and the carbon dioxide in the blood. And we know that the bicarbonate is determined by the metabolic processes of the body, and the carbon dioxide is determined by the respiratory component of the body. So kidney and the lung, and that is how this equation is maintained. So the pH or the hydrogen ion concentration is determined by bicarbonate and PCO2. There is another equation which you should be aware of, which we call as Henderson equation. It is an equation which tells you a universal truth. And what we mean by this universal truth is that hydrogen ion concentration is equal to 24 multiplied by PCO2 and bicarbonate. So we know that the normal hydrogen ion concentration is 40 nanoequivalent, the normal PCO2 is 40, and bicarbonate is 24 milliequivalent. So if you multiply 24 into 40 by 24, it becomes 40. And the normal hydrogen ion concentration is also 40. So this means that if you independently know all the three values, so that means if you are interpreting your ABG, it is important that you should have independently measured hydrogen ion from pH, PCO2 from the ABG machine, and bicarbonate independently from the laboratory. This bicarbonate should not be a calculated parameter from your ABG machine. So if you have three values independently and you put into this equation, you can check the correctness or the internal validity of your ABG. Now let us go into simple acid-base disorders. The simple acid-base disorder are associated with either derangement in the PCO2 or derangement in the bicarbonate. So if there is a primary decrease or increase in the bicarbonate, we will call it metabolic disorders. If there is a primary increase or decrease in the PCO2, we will call it respiratory disorder. So metabolic acidosis is primary decrease in the bicarbonate. Metabolic alkalosis is primary increase in the bicarbonate. Respiratory acidosis is primary increase in the PCO2, and respiratory alkalosis is primary decrease in the PCO2. So you can see here from this Anderson-Hasselbalch equation that the pH is dependent on bicarbonate and PCO2. So when a person has metabolic acidosis, there is a primary decrease in the bicarbonate. If there is a metabolic alkalosis, there is a primary increase in the bicarbonate. If there is a primary increase in the PCO2, there is a respiratory acidosis. So whenever there is a one pathophysiological process, that means whenever there is a decrease in bicarbonate, in order to keep the pH normal or near normal, the other component also decreases. So if in a primary process of metabolic acidosis, there is a decrease in bicarbonate, so the body will tend to decrease the PCO2 levels so that the ratio between the two remains more or less near normal. So the primary disorder is decrease in bicarbonate. The other body's response of decrease in PCO2, we call it as a compensatory response. So what is this compensatory response? The compensatory response basically tends to return the pH back to normal, but never completely. It tends to bring the pH back to close to normal, and it never normalizes except one condition, which we that is primary respiratory alkalosis. This process of compensatory response requires normally functioning kidney and lungs, because for a response to bicarbonate, the lung should be working, and for a change in the PCO2, the kidney should be working. The compensatory response usually results in a second disorder, because if in response to decrease in the bicarbonate, there is a decrease in PCO2, so there is actually a disorder of respiratory alkalosis. The expected amount of compensation can be easily calculated by standard formula, and if you find that the compensation is not as per the expectation or the formula, then actually the patient has second primary disorders and it is not a part of compensatory process. So these are the formulas which you should be aware of, that if suppose in metabolic acidosis, we know that there is a primary decrease in the bicarbonate, and suppose if the patient has a fall in bicarbonate from a normal of 24 to 15, then what will be the likely PCO2 this patient will have? So you will multiply 1.5 into 15, which will be 22.5, and you can add 8, that means 30.5, and plus minus 2, that means 28.5 to 32.5. So the expected PCO2 will be something between 28 to 32. So that's how you calculate. Similarly, in metabolic alkalosis, there is a increase in the bicarbonate, and suppose if a patient has primary metabolic alkalosis and his bicarbonate is 30, then the delta bicarbonate, that means the normal bicarbonate is 24, this patient has 30, the delta bicarbonate will be 6. So you multiply 0.6 into delta bicarbonate, and in this case say it will be 3.6, and you add it into 40, so the expected PCO2 will be 43. This thing. For respiratory acidosis and alkalosis, the compensations will be immediate and delayed. As I mentioned to you, kidney, for a change in the PCO2, there will be a change in the bicarbonate. And as I mentioned to you, kidneys may take time to either regenerate bicarbonate or excrete bicarbonate. So in a respiratory acidosis, normally, for every change in the PCO2, particularly increase of PCO2 of 10, in acute circumstances, there will be an increase in the bicarbonate of 1. Whereas in chronic condition, for every increase in the PCO2 of 10, the increase in bicarbonate will be of 3.5. Similarly, in cases of respiratory alkalosis, for every decrease in the PCO2 of 10, in an acute circumstances, the bicarbonate will decrease by 2, whereas in chronic condition, for every decrease in the PCO2, the bicarbonate will decrease by 5. Now, once you diagnose that your patient has got metabolic acidosis and you make this diagnosis by primary decrease in the bicarbonate, then it becomes very important to know what is the etiological mechanism of this metabolic acidosis. Now, we know that metabolic acidosis can be produced by three mechanisms. One, if there is an excess production of acids or abnormal acids, and what you see, which cannot be excreted by the kidney, which overwhelms the total renal capacity. And this happens particularly in uremic, in diabetic ketoacidosis, the alcohol toxicities. The in other situation, the metabolic acidosis can be produced by loss of alkali. Here the acid is not added, but there is a loss of alkali, and that happens in diarrhea. And the third condition where a person can develop metabolic acidosis is when kidney disease occurs, in chronic kidney diseases, where kidney is not able to excrete even the normal acid load of the body. So, to differentiate between these three types of acidosis, which you have diagnosed on the basis of fall in bicarbonate, we have to do what we call as anion gap. So, to differentiate between the first and the second condition, we use anion gap. The anion gap will be wide in the first condition where there is an excess acid production, abnormal acid production. In the second situation where there is a loss of alkali, the anion gap will be normal. And in the third condition, we actually do the urine anion gap, and the normal negative urine anion gap becomes positive in the third condition. Here you can see that normally we have positively charged ion, which we call as cations. We have a negatively charged ions, which we call anions. And in the body, there is a electroneutrality. So what you see that under normal circumstances, all positive charge ion, the cations, are equal to all negative charge ion, which are the anions. There are anions which we commonly measures. There are anions which we don't measure. The anions which we commonly don't measure are what we call unmeasured anions. And similarly, we measured some cations which are commonly which we measure, like sodium, potassium, other metals, calcium and other thing, but there are other cations which we don't measure. So unmeasured cation anions plus chloride and bicarbonate, which we commonly measure, is equal to unmeasured cations plus sodium, or you can add potassium to this thing. So normally they are equal, and if you rewrite this equation, the unmeasured anion minus unmeasured cation is equal to anion, what we called as anion gap. That means under normal circumstances, unmeasured anions are more than unmeasured cation, and the normal anion gap is 12. So here you can see that this is the cations, and the normal cations which we commonly measure are sodium, which is 140, and potassium, which is 4, and the unmeasured cations. These unmeasured cations are calcium, magnesium, and proteins. On the other hand, if you see the anions commonly measured anions are chloride 104 and bicarbonate, which is 24, and then we have unmeasured anions, and these are as you can see are phosphates, sulfates, and proteins. So you can very easily see here that unmeasured anions are more than unmeasured cations, and the difference between two is called anion gap, which is normally equal to 12. The condition in which there is a change in the anion gap. The anion gap is mainly caused by protein molecules, which we don't measure. There is an increased anion gap when there is an unmeasured anions are raised, or as I told you, this may be in the form of sulfates and phosphates, or unmeasured cations like calcium, magnesium, and potassium are reduced. Or the third situation, when there is an increase in the albumin, due to albumin excess, or alkalosis, which alters albumin charge. Decrease in the anion gap most frequently occurs due to hypoalbuminemia. So when you have a patient with hypoalbuminemia, then in that case it is very important to calculate the adjusted anion gap, and in that case you can take the normal value. Suppose your patient has got a albumin of, say, instead of 4 he has an albumin of 2, then the anion gap will change, the normal anion gap will fall accordingly. So for every 1 gram of albumin, the anion gap changes by 2 to 3 value. So if a patient has a albumin of 2 grams, then his normal anion gap is likely to be 6. So these are the common conditions you can see which are associated with wide anion gap: acidosis like methanol, uremia, diabetic ketoacidosis, pyrrolidehyde toxicity, lactic acidosis, ethanol, ethylene glycol, and salicylate. Normal gap with hypokalemia, you can see diarrhea, and all these GI conditions you can see, plus the renal tubular acidosis. Similarly, with normal anion gap, and you can see as normokalemia or hypokalemia, you have adrenal insufficiency or type 4 RTA. The next thing which I told you, that by using anion gap, wide and this thing, we can distinguish two types of metabolic acidosis. The first one, where there is an increased production of acids; the second one, where there is loss of alkali. The third condition, where which is associated with chronic renal disease, and if the acidemia is due to renal tubular acidosis and kidneys not in a position to excrete the normal acid load, the physiological acid load, that we can calculate by measuring the urine anion gap. And this we can measure, the urine anion gap is measured with urinary sodium plus urine potassium minus urinary chloride. Now we know that the kidney excretes most of its acid by forming ammonium, and when it forms ammonium, it forms ammonium chloride, and so the urinary chloride is usually much more than urine sodium and potassium, and that is why under normal circumstances the urine anion gap is negative. But in chronic renal disease, the kidney is not able to generate ammonia, the chloride goes less, so the urine anion gap becomes positive. So if you get a positive urine anion gap, then it may suggest renal tubular acidosis as a cause of hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis. Now, if you are considering mixed acid-base disorder, that means you have a patient where you think your patient has got metabolic acidosis, but if you think along with metabolic acidosis, patient may have metabolic alkalosis, or patient may have respiratory alkalosis. So this becomes a mixed disorder. Sometimes the patient may have metabolic acidosis, metabolic alkalosis, or the patient can have metabolic acidosis, metabolic alkalosis, and respiratory acidosis. So these double or triple disorders, when you want to diagnose, in that situation you have to understand the term what we called as delta gap. Now what this delta gap is? The delta gap is measured when, as I mentioned to you, when you are suspecting mixed acid base disorder, and delta gap is normally delta anion gap minus delta bicarbonate. Now what is delta anion gap? As I mentioned to you, that under normal physiological condition, the delta anion gap is 12. If you add any acid, which is unmeasurable acid in the form of, say, lactates or ketones, so this will lead to increase in the anion gap. And each molecule of lactate or ketone, when you add, one molecule of bicarbonate is consumed. So whenever you will see that you add an extra acid, there is an increase in delta anion gap, there will be an equal decrease in the bicarbonate, or there will be a change in the delta bicarbonate. So the delta, under normal circumstances, the delta bicarbonate and delta anion gap will be equal, and the difference between delta anion gap and delta bicarbonate will be zero. So delta gap will be normally zero. But if suppose this delta gap is not zero, then it indicates, if it is zero, it indicates simple metabolic acidosis. But if it is not zero, then it is a mixed double or a triple disorder. And if you find that delta bicarbonate is less than delta anion gap, then it indicates mixed high anion gap metabolic acidosis, which is the baseline problem, along with metabolic alkalosis. That means when these two are differences not zero, and when delta bicarbonate is less than delta anion gap, that means there is an addition of bicarbonate. Similarly, if delta bicarbonate is less than delta anion gap, then that means that there is a pathophysiological process which is causing further decrease in the bicarbonate, and that may be in the form of normal anion gap metabolic acidosis. So by using this, we are able to differentiate between these. And the last thing which you have to know is the osmolar gap. And the osmolar gap, as you can see, is calculated by 2 multiplied by sodium levels plus glucose levels divided by 18 plus blood urea nitrogen divided by 2.8. And this is the osmolar gap. So you have the measured gap, and then you have the calculated. And normally this difference is less than 10. And if the osmolar gap increases, it usually indicate that the metabolic acidosis is caused by alcohol or methanol toxicity, or there is a spuriously low sodium, as you see in hyperlipidemias or hyperproteinemias. So these are the important things which you have to understand. So to finally, if you want to approach a patient with acid-base disorder, it is very important that you approach this patient systematically, so that by following a set pattern, you will not be able to miss double or triple disorders. So the first thing what you have to do is to search for a cause rather than immediately normalize the values. So don't have a knee-jerk reaction to acid-base disorder. Try to understand the pathophysiological mechanism. And if you treat those, acid-base abnormality automatically corrects. So look for the history which may suggest you for a particular acid-base disorder, like vomiting indicate normal anion gap, indicate metabolic alkalosis, diarrhea, normal anion gap metabolic acidosis, sepsis, diabetes, wide anion gap metabolic acidosis. So you take the detailed physical history, look for fever, volume depletion, which is commonly associated with metabolic alkalosis, respiratory rate, if it is low, indicate primary respiratory acidosis, blood pressure, hypotension, metabolic acidosis, hyperlactatemia. So these are the conditions. Look for the electrolytes and look for the urinary electrolytes. So then the first step is you should see whether there is an internal consistency of the values which you have got. So you apply the Henderson equation and put all the 3 values which you have got into this equation, and then see whether both sides are equal. So once this point is cleared, then you go to the step 2 and you see and determine whether your patient has got acidemia when the pH is less than 7.36, or alkalemia when the pH is 7.44. In mixed disorder, it is very important to know that pH may be normal. So when you have a normal pH but abnormal PCO2 and bicarbonate, always suspect that your patient has got mixed disorder. So once you find a primary disorder, say a primary disturbance of respiratory or metabolic, in this patient with acidemia, if there is an increase in PCO2, it will indicate primary respiratory acidosis. If it is associated with decrease in the bicarbonate, then it will indicate primary metabolic acidosis. And in patient with alkalemia, a decrease in the PCO2 will indicate primary respiratory alkalosis, and when there is an increase in the bicarbonate, it is associated with primary metabolic alkalosis. Step 4, once you have found a particular primary disorder, then you look for the compensation, and as I mentioned to you, the various formulas, according to that you look for the compensation, and if the compensation is as per the formula which I had already mentioned to you, then it is an adequate compensation. If the compensation is not as per the expectation, then you suspect that your patient has got a second primary disorder. The next step then is, if you have a patient with respiratory alkalosis, you similarly apply that formula and look for the compensation. In patients who have got metabolic acidosis, you look for the anion gap, and after the anion gap, if still there is a doubt in the interpretation, you look for the urine anion gap. And when you are suspecting multiple disorders, you go for the delta gap, and from then you put it all together, and then you come to know what is the final diagnosis. So thank you very much for your kind attention.